Hi everyone. In this video, we'll talk about how large language models convert objects to representations. Let's take an example where you have a large language model that is being used for translations. Okay, let's say you are on a Zoom call with me and you make the statement, she is going there. The pronoun she tells me that it's a woman who's going. But the equivalent statement in Hindi is wo wahan ja rahi hai. Rahi is the place where I get the gender, which is equivalent to going in English. So if I try to do a direct translation, word to word, from English to Hindi, I'll have a problem. How do I solve this problem? Is it a real problem, firstly? Yes, large language models are heavily trained on English data, which means that if I try to make it work with Hindi data or with Spanish data, it's going to focus so much on the word composition and on the grammar of English, the translations might be poor. So for me to improve the translation in every single language, I can do either of two things. One is I can take all the different n square combinations, where n is the number of languages in the world, and I can look at how I can translate from one language to another, or I can look at an intermediate representation into a vector space. If we could have sentence to sentence mapping, the large language model could somehow encapsulate this entire statement into a single vector, into a single representation in an n-dimensional space. When generating the same meaning in Hindi, it would look at this single meaning, then generate that statement. So this idea of sentence level encoding is what Facebook has tried with large concept models. It has some big benefits and some big drawbacks also. I'll tell you the drawbacks beforehand. There are many sentences in the world that you can make. There's basically infinite number of sentences that you can make. An example of this is she's going there, she will be going there, she may be going there, and all of these are different statements. If I had a token-to-token comparison, then this would be easy because most of the words are common. But if I have a sentence-based comparison, then that's all different sentences. All of them have different representations. So some of the work seems to be redundant because there is so many different concepts which are actually all very similar. But the benefit is also clear. This is great for long context questions where you have lots of statements. Each of those statements then are mapped to a single point. And so it's easy for the model to have the context of the input query, even if it's a long one. Another clear benefit which we have talked about is that different languages can be answered very well using this kind of a model. And probably the biggest potential benefit is text to image generation. Since the entire text of a statement can be converted into a single vector, we are able to better encapsulate its meaning and context, resulting in higher quality and more accurate images. I don't think this is entirely because you have taken a concept and converted it into a single vector. There's previous research that Facebook has done with ImageBIND. I'll briefly describe it here, but you can skip it in case you're not very interested in the technical details. The basic idea here is taking objects of one type and then mapping them to a vector space. We then take two of these vectors, say cats and cheeseburgers, and then find their corresponding images. Once we have the vectors of these images, we can forcefully align the image vector of cats to the text vector of cats. This can be done with a concept from computer graphics, where the points are translated, scaled, and rotated as required. If all of the points in the two vector spaces coincide, we can say that all the vectors are aligned and that our model has a common understanding of multiple modalities. Facebook used a large dataset of images where every image had a textual description. They then generated vectors for each of these images and then trained the model to align its text vectors to the images. The result was a vector space where image descriptions and text descriptions mapped to the same points. In a similar way, Facebook aligned video and audio files to the image files. The result was that a new object of any type could be mapped to any other type without requiring an intermediate mapping to images. This is being called emergent alignment, where mapping objects from any modality to images is resulting in their overall alignment. This has resulted in state-of-the-art recognition capabilities, even outperforming previously specialized models. And this, in my view, has tremendous applications. I stay in a country called India. We have 22 official languages and hundreds of spoken languages. If you have a language agnostic model, if you have a multimodal model, the vector representation here is much more robust and stable than it would be otherwise if you were specifically trained on just English or just Hindi. That's pretty much it. Large language models, when they are looking to represent any kind of objects, this is what they do. They convert them into embeddings or vectors, and the representation determines how closely the model performs to expectation. So I'll see you next time. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye. Yes, I'm going to go on a small, I won't say rant, but a justification for this video. There is an MIT professor, Patrick Winston, who very recently passed away, and he was one of my favorite professors. He gave a step-by-step breakdown of how you should solve problems. And I think he wasn't just talking about AI, he was talking in general, but it really relates very well with large language models. So I'll just share it with you here. The first idea is definition. So you define what the problem is. Even now humans do that for large language models. The second point is representation, which we are looking at. Okay, and that's why this is so exciting for me, because he says that if you represent the problem the right way, most of your problems are solved. Okay, but most people focus on the next two parts, which is algorithm and implementation. Okay, algorithm in our case would be the transformer. But really, even before the transformer, you need to look at how you're representing the data, the vectors, because the transformer may be replaced by some other thing tomorrow. There's RKMV and other linear models which are trying to replace this. Transformer has order n square time complexity when it comes to finding attention. This can be changed, but the representation doesn't change, right? Then there's implementation. Should I implement this in C++ or Python, right? Facebook implemented it in C++. You might find a better GPU. You might, I don't mean to say implementation is not important, but this is more about translating what you have as an idea into the real world. Okay, this is where the engineers come in, and at best they go here to algorithm, but it feels so good to also look at the representation side, the research side. All right, so thank you for watching this video. If you are curious about whether an AI course is coming at interview ready, yes it is. Until next time, see you. Bye-bye.